Welcome all, Rodge here, aka the Wisco Horn Dog, back again for another Saga Thursday, your regular source for Saga miniatures goodness. Today, we're going to take a look at the Priest Rules, which came out in Crescent and Cross, and they've since been released on their website. They've undergone a revision or two, as we'll chat about, but these rules are pretty cool. I think they add some interesting variety to the different warband options, and definitely worth considering when constructing your force. And I got the People's Viking, Mr. Mikey G, on to help us along, stumble through this, figure it out, and we're gonna check this out.
I've got the People's Viking back on here to help me out with some priest chat. So as I went through the Saga Rules videos, there's three of them in total. One thing I purposely kind of jumped around and didn't mention specifically were the Priest Rules, which came out in Crescent and Cross, because I thought they deserved their own kind of show topic for sure. And they're quite juicy, quite interesting. I think we have a lot to talk about. So I invited Mikey G on here. How's it going, Mikey?
Pretty good. How are you, buddy?
Yeah, I'm good. Good night. I can hear the dirty beast. He's with Kelly right now, just so he's not alone in a room crying.
You're not a horrible father.
Yeah, I'm not. Well, at least that we know. I'm partially horrible, obviously, but he's hanging out with mommy, and I may be able to cut this out of the audio track, his crying, but maybe not. I don't know. But Okay. So, he's an animal.
He's going hard.
Yeah, he's going hard. He's going hard tonight. He's wild. We are going to chat about the priests. So, okay, one thing is the priests came out in the Crescent and Cross rulebook, and they were pretty good. One of them was maybe really good. Maybe
like stupid good.
Stupid good, yeah. And during this summer, they revised the rules for priests via a FAQ on their website, and I'll have a link to it below, but they've got a nice PDF up now that basically just has the new rules for it. So I don't really want to get into what the rules were necessarily, since those aren't the rules anymore. If you're playing with your buddies and stuff and nobody uses the internet, just be aware that if they're using a priest, you could point out that they've been fact. But I know not everybody's always plugged in. So we're just going to talk about the new rules, which they're similar. They're just slightly toned down, slightly different. But we're not even really going to get into what they were. So just to keep things simpler. But okay, so you want to... What's a priest, Mikey? How do I get a priest in my warband?
You can get a priest in your warband by two different ways. One is either to use a point. So instead of 4 Hearthguard, 8 Warriors, 12 Levy, you can take along one of the priest models. Or you can replace your warlord with said priest. Then it comes for free. So it is simply just a swap out, and the priest gains, I believe, determination and warlord's pride if that happens. So they will then be able to activate for free once, and then if you are within movement distance of your opponent's warlord, your priest will have to go toe to toe.
Yeah, you're going in, baby.
Going in hot.
The wise man shows
crippled
no fear.
Crippled old white man with your little stick. Let's do this. Yeah.
That's interesting. He also, if he's your warlord, he gains the warlord's equipment, like if it's mandatory. So he could have a Dane axe.
Oh, sure.
Yep. So you're enlightened.
Yep.
Could have a Dane on 2+. As far as the options go, for just the regular priest, I think it follows the warlord too, where if the warlord can be mounted, then the priest can also be mounted.
Yep, you're right.
besides that. So during the game, they're activated like warlords. So you'd use the warlord tile. Anything that affects a warlord, I guess, for saga abilities and stuff, affects the priest the same way. So if it's an ability that can't target a warlord, it can't target a priest.
Yep.
I believe I'm reading that correctly.
Yes.
And then a priest is worth 4 slaughtering victory points, which I think the warlord is just 3, right?
He's just worth a little bit high.
One more, which is kind of interesting. So that's cool. I think maybe we'll go through the 3 priests and then maybe circle back around to when you would take a warlord priest, because I think that's a kind of an interesting option. Because mm-hmm. The warlord is pretty tough, so yep. I think you'd have to be an interesting circumstance where you'd rather take a priest. But okay, well, let's get into the priest. So the first one, the religious advisor. So he is there not to fight, but to support the men and to witness their bravery. He will write or sing of the magnificent feats that were performed this day. He can be a scald, a monk, a Celtic druid, imam. Should be depicted by an unarmed figure. And he just has 1 attack. His armor is 4 in melee, 4 against shooting. And he generates 1 saga dice. He has, for special rules, resilience. So he ignores the first hit and can have schlubs jump in the way and save him, correct? That's
yep.
resilience? Okay.
Yep.
And then he has 2 special abilities here that are pretty cool. So the first one is spiritual advice. At the start of your turn, if the religious advisor is within short of your warlord, the maximum number of saga dice you may roll is increased by 1, but it can't exceed 8 because that's the maximum number of dice. And there's a little addendum. If the religious advisor is your warlord, then you just always get that. So, yeah, I think that's pretty cool because most of the time, I would say most warbands generate more than 6 at the start of the game.
Yeah.
My Anglo-Saxons only generated 5, but I'm an idiot and shouldn't be following my advice. Yeah, so that's good. So he generates 1 on his own. So he's not generating more than like a Hearthguard unit. You know, you're paying a point. You know, he's generating the same. But with this, basically, he's kind of generating an extra 1. Now, the tough thing is keeping him within short.
Yes.
Because, you know, at the beginning, it's not an issue. But during the game, it's, you know, it costs dice to move him. And, you know, generally, he could be exposed as well if he's keeping up with your warlord, depending how you are using him in the game. And then, so his second ability is Faith. At any point during your orders phase, your priest may suffer up to 2 fatigue markers, and he must stop if he's exhausted. For each fatigue suffered in this way, you may activate one of the following abilities. Roll an extra saga die, or remove a fatigue from a unit with an M of the advisor. And you can only use each of those once per turn. So you can't take 2 fatigues to generate 2 saga dice, or take 2 fatigues to remove 2 fatigues from a unit. You can use 1 of each. Okay. Cool. These are good. Yeah, so I think between these 2, most of the time he'll be adding 2 saga dice to your warband at the start of the game. And
yep.
probably for, you know, at least half the game, he'll be generating 2 more than you would normally get. And then probably, you know, maybe halfway through, you'd be getting 1 more than you normally would until the fatigue stacks up. So I like that second ability, remove 1 fatigue
yes.
from a unit. So already you can combo that with a rest activation or some other kind of thing and take for yourself from 2 to 0 before you go in. It's kind of a trade. It's nice. It doesn't cost any saga ability, you know, dice to do these things. So if you don't have the saga dice for a rest, I can pop a fatigue on the advisor and go to town.
The one thing with this guy, you have to be very careful about not using these abilities too much towards the beginning of the game, because the only way to get fatigue off of him, and unless your battle board has some way of doing that, is to rest him. And so, even to roll an extra saga die and gaining a fatigue, you're almost just, you could take that same dice and then use it to activate him for a rest. So, like, when you think about it, there's not really a great way to take fatigue off of him. To me, the faith abilities especially need to be kind of reserved for, like, when you need them. Like, shit is hitting the fan. I need to get some more juice going with my warband, or I need to take off some fatigue because I got to go in and hard. That's kind of when you utilize those abilities. Because if you use them too early on, you're essentially just using them to rest your dude back.
You're kind of just delaying, payment for, the licks that you're taking. Mm-hmm. You're postponing when you're going to have to rest those units. But in some way, you're taking the rest from a different unit and kind of putting it on him. Yeah. So he's taking those sins upon him, Michael.
Right.
And he will save them. There's a little addendum in the bottom here that says that you can only use these abilities during your turn, your orders phase. So you can't pop a surprise fatigue removal off one of your guys in the opponent's turn or anything like that. And then I think it specifically says it doesn't work with the Scott's ability without mercy. Is that like the extra free turn?
Yeah, that's the extra like three dice out of orders reaction thing that they can do.
Mm-hmm.
This is a really nice, not to speak too much of what priests could do before, but that was always one of the old things with Scott's, is to use a advisor to boost that. It was like a four or five dice turn out of turn. So I was really glad that they added this to this model.
Yeah, okay, so let's take a look at, I guess, kind of evaluate him, his merit. So it gives you the ability to generate more saga dice than you normally would be able to. Now, some battle boards, this could be an issue on. Like, I'm thinking my Anglo-Saxon board. Some boards don't have that generic ability that just lets you roll more when you get rares. And some boards you just need more dice due to the, two dice abilities and stuff like that. And, a lot of the times in your games, you're going to have a unit or two that is just hanging back just because you don't have enough dice to move it forward. So, I think it's pretty decent. It's not an auto include, maybe, whereas it was before, where it generated so many more saga dice. I think it's kind of in the sweet spot where I think if you take it, you're not, it's balanced. It's not better or worse than not taking it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I think it's balanced. Yeah.
To me, this is tricky. The spiritual advice to me seems like the better ability out of all of them, just because it's always active and it's theoretically free.
Mm-hmm.
What gets a little bit tricky is that, again, for board, you say like, okay, so for boards that are dice starved, right, you would use this dude to sit next to your warlord and allow you to generate more dice to use. But if you're moving your warlord up at all, you're then having to spend dice to move your religious advisor. So even that extra dice that you've theoretically generated, you might have to be pouring back into moving and or resting this guy. So you have to be a little bit careful that you're not like outdoing what you're actually producing, like that he's not using more resources that he's actually producing. I see this as spiritual advice up until the point of you where you need that juiced up turn. Like you... Again, I wouldn't use faith very often until I really am getting into the thick of things, and then the ability to go, I'm going to take two fatigue, roll an extra die, drop a fatigue from a unit. I can do that again next turn, and then he's pretty much done for the game, but I've got two juice turns That's how I would see the religious advisor at this point.
True, yeah. That's a good point. And I guess maybe two, you know, is slightly more beneficial to those defensive type warbands where you don't necessarily are trying to get your warlord out there, you know, versus some other warbands. So, okay. Cool. I think he's decent. I think he's fun. If you want to take it, just fucking take it, dude. Okay. So, the warrior priest, this guy is cool. Now, with the recent FAQ, I don't believe he really changed at all.
Or he didn't change in the slightest.
Yeah, maybe there's some clarification or something.
The blade that punishes. So he's got an ability that he can use. Basically, all these priests got that line where it says, your ability can't be used during your opponent's turn. It's only got to be used in your own. I think that's a change for the warrior priest. So you can only use his special ability during your turn.
Yeah, I think that's fine. I think that's main sense. I think that actually did come up in a couple of my games. While I did play as the religious advisor, I haven't played him since these rules have changed. But the warrior priest I have played, you know, kind of using these rules. And he's cool. I think he's fine. So the warrior priest, basically, he's got a sword or an axe. The model would be armed and could be a fearsome leader from a Celtic war cult, an Islamic Quadi, Christian bishop, savage Nord, Godai. He's decent. He's got 3 attacks. His armor is 5 in melee, 6 against shooting. He generates a saga die. He has the side-by-side ability, order we obey, and resilience for those 3. So, yeah, he really is kind of like a mini warlord before you get into the blade that punishes. So he can, when he moves, he can bring another unit with him.
Yep.
So he's kind of, you know, he's generating a saga die, but he is kind of paying for himself a little bit.
Yes.
You're getting 2 units to move.
The dice that you would have spent to move that unit, you can move him and that unit with. And then they can go into combat with him with order wheel.
Yes. Yep. And that's definitely cool. Now, the good thing here is the blade that punishes, which when you kind of glance at it, it doesn't seem that good. But, you know, one thing is it does all 3 of these things. It's not just one
right.
thing that you choose, which I think the first couple times I looked at it, I just assumed it was that. You just choose one of these. But it's actually all 3 of these. And it's pretty awesome. Once you pop this, I think you're better than a warlord. But okay, during your orders phase, so that is the key thing there during your orders phase, and I've screwed myself over a couple times.
Yep.
But you can discard any one of your saga dice you rolled, so common, uncommon, rare, to gain the following benefits. So the priest generates 3 extra attack dice in this melee. Or in melee, in general.
Yep.
He discards a fatigue immediately, so that is dope. And then any non-levy unit that engages in melee alongside your priest, using the order we obey and side-by-side rules, generates 1 extra attack die for every 2 of its models, rounded up as usual. All these benefits last until the start of your next orders phase. That's juicy. Mm-hmm. So, first one, you go to 3 attacks to 6. Now, there isn't any further clarification here. Now, could that be boosted for, you know, is that already doubled then and he's capped? Or
no.
Is he starting? I would read that as he starts at 6.
And he starts at 6 because that's what he generates. So, generation of, like, the dice that you generate, that's your original pool. So, he starts at 6. And then he could be boosted to 12, theoretically.
Okay, so he discards a fatigue. So you're using a dice. So basically he's resting for free, gaining these other abilities. And he could still rest on top of all this.
Yep.
And then any non-levy unit. So if you combo this with a 12-man warrior or even a Hearthguard unit, you're going to get 6 extra attack die. So This guy's fun. I think he's definitely a fair value for sure. He kind of pays for himself as far as activations. He's getting as much as he's taking, so it's not an order sink. And then the reason I was using him was for the Anglo-Saxons was it wasn't that easy to generate more attacks. And I think I'd also use him in the Anglo-Dane Warband because they have real garbage for generating more attacks. So I think just anything to get more attacks, I would definitely consider this guy.
Yep. I've been looking at him now for Pagan Rus because he has resilience like a warlord, theoretically it has the same dice cap restrictions. So you can only allocate up to half of your attack dice against him, which makes him a perfect target for biting like wolves, where, you know, if you don't hit him, he's going to do a bunch of damage at you. As well as, similarly, Pagan Rus don't generate that many attack dice. There's only like one, I think, ability that really adds attack dice, and in fact has abilities that take your attack dice away for defense. And so the ability to bring in a big unit of warriors, say, and generate a bunch of extra attack dice is a really big deal. So as you said, I think warbands that don't have ways of generating a lot of attack can make a lot of use out of this model. And at the end of the day, like, you know, as we've kind of said, like he the dice you use to activate him, at least the first one, he's getting a side by side, so it's basically like spending it on the unit anyway. And he gives you the option of going just ham on somebody with six attack dice, a boatload extra for a unit that goes in, and being kind of tanky himself at armor 5, 6 with resilience.
Yeah, and so we should say any saga abilities that affect the warlord can be used on these priests. So, you know, with the visor, unless you have, you know, some kind of defensive abilities, you're typically not going to be using them. But if you have some kick-ass attack abilities on your board, you know, this is another model that you can use those on. And, you know, it's kind of a safe way to indulge in those abilities because you're not putting your warlord at risk, but you're getting, you know, presumably some kick-ass benefits out of it. So, yeah, I think this guy's good. I like him. I like him a lot. And finally, we have the Enlightened, which is supposed to be kind of like a hermit, more monastic type of fellow, a mystic type dude, to differentiate him from the religious advisor. So, one attack on this guy, armor 3. In melee, 5 against shooting, so slightly better against shooting.
It's than a little cagey.
Religious advice. A little cagey. He's got those thick robes. You know, hangs out outside. You know, so he likes to stretch his legs from time to time. Generates 1 saga die. Okay, so he's got resilience, same as the other ones. So he can take the hits. Well, not too many hits, but at least one.
Not a lot. Yep.
Take a hit.
Yep.
And so his special ability is called Visionary. During his order phase, after having rolled a saga dice, but before any abilities are activated by the controlling player, the Enlightened may suffer any number of fatigue markers, but must stop when exhausted. So you have to use this you can't start activating things and then use this.
Correct.
Any abilities. So even like you roll that rare and you want to use it for 2 dice, you wouldn't be able to use that
until you've done your
visionary stuff. So, okay. All right. So, so for each fatigue you take, you can take a saga dice and change the symbol to whatever you want. So presumably you will be taking a common dice and changing it to a rare, most likely, but maybe an uncommon if you got some sweet stuff. You can do this to 2 dice for the same symbol. So you could take 2. That kid's wild. He's a wild man. Dang. And He's just playing. He's not being tortured.
I love how you kind of have to throw that out there.
Yeah. It's with Kelly. He's having a good time.
Don't call children services on me, please.
Please. Okay. You can change two commons to two rares, which would be awesome. Their example is the Anglo-Danish change two dice to a rare so you can use the trapped ability. Is their example, which is probably an apt example. But if you do that, if you do a double like that, you're going to suffer one extra fatigue for doing that. And then if you use the visionary special rule, you actually can't gain any extra saga dice during this orders phase. So that's huge. Correct. So
yep.
Our example was you had to wait to burn that rare to get the two dice, while you're going to be waiting your whole turn because you can't even do that.
Yep.
So that's interesting. So you can't – so it really kind of differentiates from the religious advisor in that stretch where the advisor adds additional dice, but this guy, you're never going to get any additional dice. It just changes what you rolled.
Correct.
Yeah. That's probably, as the fluff, that's the way that they're differentiating these two.
So you're typically capped at probably your six dice.
Six.
But, you might be able to modify the symbols, get the dice that you need. If you have abilities that key off of a lot of rares or uncommons, something like that.
Yeah, so I think that was just kind of a clever way. We want to help. We have these two different types of priests. We want them both to help the war bands, but we want them to do it differently. So how do we do that? So this is how it's accomplished. Okay, so it's got that same addendum, although I don't really see how it would apply, but. Okay, so this one, I guess, kind of depends on your warband. If you're a guy who likes to come up with a plan and doesn't like it when the dice don't follow the plan, then you have this guy in your back pocket to keep that plan alive. But it kind of follows the same kind of trap where once he gets these fatigues on him, then you're kind of spinning your wheels a bit.
Well, you're not even... So, the religious advisor, as you're gaining fatigues, you're theoretically adding saga dice, which could then be poured back into resting, right? So, you're straight spinning your wheels. This dude, you're not gaining dice. You're just changing them to better symbols. So, every dice that you would utilize to rest him is that much more painful that you're theoretically losing.
Yeah, and you're not going to be getting any extra because of his little restriction. Right. So they're a little more costly. Now, the one thing is he doesn't have to keep up with the warband at all.
Correct. Sit him in the backfield and let him do his thing.
Yeah, he really could just go in a corner. A lot of that's going to depend on the scenario and the warband you're fighting against, but probably at least half the games he could just sit back there and he'll be perfectly fine. I guess it kind of really depends on your board because you get enough rares. Now, the issue is if you require two rares, that's something that you might not ever get during the course of your entire game. Two rares, is probably going to happen. But if you're kind of whole plan keys off of having that, being able to pop it in turns three and four for sure in order to unleash hell, this is the guy for you then.
Yep.
This one I've never seen anybody use. Have you?
Nope, never seen him used. I think, again, similarly to the religious advisor, it's about supercharging one or two of your turns, right? Because theoretically, if you're rolling six dice, you're probably going to get a rare. So even if you have to use two rares, you're only spending one fatigue to make that happen.
Yes.
So you could theoretically do that for four turns before getting exhausted and thus kind of losing out on your efficiency. And then it's also like it's turn four, I'm getting into combats that are really big, I need the double rare, I don't roll any of them. well, fuck it. Let's go hard. I'm going to put 355
and go.
He's
kind of done once he does that.
Right.
Because he has to stop when he's exhausted.
Yep.
But, okay. Yeah, I think the Enlightened would probably be one where you would think to yourself, okay, I want to take an Enlightened. What warband do I have that would make the best use of it? You know,
yeah.
And kind of build it around there just for funsies. So, yeah, probably the weakest, I would say, or maybe trickiest to use. But
unless you're playing Vikings and are just going Ragnarok, just going hard on that Ragnarok.
Yeah, just because you like shouting Ragnarok.
Right, yep.
Is like the main, your main...
Just juicing it out.
Your main pleasure there. Okay, cool. So, okay, I said we'd circle back around, but a warlord priest. So, would you ever take an enlightened warlord?
No.
Discounting that there's scenarios that you're basically in the squared circle and you start fighting immediately. If you knew you weren't doing one of those, I don't know. The religious advisor, I think you could get away with more. I think he's doing more for the warband than the enlightened is. And I guess it kind of depends on the faction, too, because some factions you really don't want your warlord up there. You don't have any abilities that are helping you out. You might be able to get away with it in those warbands. Would you ever take a warrior priest instead of a warlord? That's an interesting question.
I would consider it. The only tricky bit with all of these, because they all generate one saga die, is that if you're swapping out for your warlord then generates only one dice. And having that two dice generation on your warlord as the game goes on and you're losing units can be a fairly big deal.
So turn one, you might just be capped at six, you won't notice, yep. But then, you know, turn five, difference between three and four dice, you know, is potentially a lot bigger.
Yep.
And, you know, when he has the blade that punishes when that's up, he is better than a warlord.
Yep.
But it costs a dice to do that. So it's almost like he's, you know, like you're going from a two dice generation to zero.
Yep.
And then it, you know, the attack bonus is only in, you know, one of your, you know, your turn only, basically.
Yep.
And you're just down to three, so you're less of a threat when they're coming after him.
Well, no, the three attacks actually, that stays until your next order's phase.
Yes,
okay. You can't activate it again in your opponent's turn, which I don't know why you would. But
yeah, so one thing with that warrior priest is if you are going to use it, I would almost get like a little... Make like your own like little homemade square cutout for your board, so you actually have something on the board to jog your memory and then remind you that you use it during your orders phase. Mm-hmm. Because there's been multiple games and multiple times where I get the action going and I'm like, oh yeah, I was going to use that dice for that, and now my whole fucking plan is gibbered up.
Yep.
So. Little tip, little pro tip for you from
nice.
The horn dog here, baby.
Okay. I think if I was going to look at a warrior priest, I would always take him separate from my warlord and only utilize his blade that... Because basically then you can utilize your warrior priest as you see fit. Basically the die that you would spend to activate him, you would spend on a unit to activate anyway. So you basically have just... He babysits a unit, gives a little bit more punch to him. And that way, at least for that first activation every turn, which you're not typically double moving anything unless you're making an attack run, you know, he's basically, it's not changing any of your dice. It's not messing with the amount of dice that you're putting in. Whereas if you have a warlord, warrior priest, that one dice generation, and the fact that you have to spend another to make him get to like the peak, the pinnacle, of warrior priestiness means that he's a little bit more expensive dice-wise for a model that now becomes a focal point of your army. Whereas when he's just an add-on, it's like, all right, cool. If I use this guy, cool. If not, I still got the Warlord tank and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I kind of agree. I think the appeal with the Warrior Priest is you got this other fighty dude who's kind of fun, and you can use all the Warlord rules without most of the downsides. And if he goes down, he goes down. But, yeah, he's cool. Yeah, I think he's probably the one I would use the most. Well, I have used the most.
Right. And I just found my new Eastern Anger target, honestly.
Oh, yeah.
Rain those arrows down, baby.
Yeah, bring it
in. Just a priest. No one gives a shit.
Yeah, absolutely. Ooh, nasty. Okay. Cool. Well, I think we covered it pretty good. Is there anything else coming to mind? We did the basic rules, some tips. So the one thing about the priest that can be a bit of a downside is in the endless warband scenarios, where he replaces Hearthguard or warriors. When those guys get killed, they can come back. When the priest is down, he ain't coming back, baby. He's done. True. So once he goes down, you lose those points. So a lot of the times, the focus in those scenarios is taking out the priest or their warlord to kind of get the edge.
And priests are worth 4 points. Like
they're a little bit more.
They're expensive. I mean, theoretically, they're worth as many points as a point of Hearthguard or a point of warriors. Like if you kill an entire unit.
Okay, that makes sense.
So it's the equivalent, right? Like 1 point being worth 4 slaughter points. But it's a model that's fairly easy to kill for those 4 points. Even a warrior priest, in comparison to a warrior unit with the amount of dice that you get to roll defensively, is much easier to kill. So, and again, in those endless warband scenarios, is not coming back to help you out.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, I think that's a good point. But priests, they're fun. If you want to use one, use
Super
one.
Fun.
If you don't, then don't. You don't have to.
They do have very cool models now. Warlord or the Gripping Beast has put out some pretty cool priest models.
Oh, cool!
So, fun to paint up.
I'll take a look. It's definitely a way to get your warband to the table quicker.
Yep.
one guy instead of 4 or 8, potentially. I definitely availed myself of that when I was trying to get everything done for Adepticon, but okay, cool. Thanks, buddy. Always insightful. Know your shit.
Sometimes.
Yeah. Most of the time. I think you're pretty good. So.
Oh,
okay.
Thanks,
yeah. We will do it again. Your fountain of knowledge. Never ending fountain. We're just going to keep having you on. It's going to be
keep
wild.
Pouring.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Beautiful.
Okay, cool. We'll talk to you later, buddy.
All right, see you, bud.
See ya.
And that sums up the priest rules for Saga. If you are interested in these, you don't necessarily need the Crescent and Cross rule book. They are available on their website, and I'll have a link below in the description to the PDF. And it's got the latest and greatest on there, and it's pretty much everything you need to rock these bad boys. I think they are definitely a fun addition to the overall Saga line. As Mikey G said, they added some sweet new models. So definitely an easy way to add some variety to your forces for new players and old players. Okay, and I think that about wraps it up. If you got anybody who's interested in Saga, please show them this video and explain to them why they need to add a priest to their warband, because they're freaking cool. Like and favorite this shit. Become a hobby horn dog today, my friends.
Saga!